Pakistan's largest inland province, but the most scarcely populated. Remote, and yet rich in mineral resources. The combination of solitude, silence, shifting sands and surreal shapes has given its deserts a mysterious charm that beckons travelers like a mirage to head out and explore these vast and oftentimes stunning expanses of our planet. Cloaked in the mist of time, the wilderness has tales to tell. Tales of a bygone era. Of mankind's earliest footprints, the Mehergarh. Located on the prime route between Central Asia and what is now Afghanistan, it once linked the then rich and wealthy Indus Valley civilization and beyond to the outer world as caravans from far-off lands cruised through these dusty paths to promising lands. This rich in history, minerals, and manpower trade route of the bygone era makes a comeback on the world markets as it strives to be the pathway of modern-day Asia's most dynamic trade tunnel, the China-Pakistan Economic Corridor. With a landmass of 347,190 square kilometers, covering almost 44% of today's Pakistan, Balochistan has held a checkered history as well as an undefined geography, surpassing the modern-day national frontiers. Amidst rich diversity of creeds, counties, clans, and climate, Balochistan presents a classic saga of time and topography. Its critical positioning on the world's trading lines lured many to acquire it, but its harsh terrain attracted very few to inhabit it. In the medieval ages, the emergence of the warm waters theory placed it at the center stage in the great game of the British imperialism and Russian czars. And in the modern times, Balochistan promises to be the gateway of the world economy. Quetta, Balochistan's capital and Pakistan's ninth most populated city. Founded by Sultan Mahmud Ghaznavi in the 10th century, it's a busy town today. The bazaars hum with activity as people across the province converge to its alleys for commerce, cure, selling, and schooling. Home to over 3 million inhabitants of diverse cultural backgrounds and races, Quetta truly personifies Balochistan, contrasting and yet coexisting. Ziyarat, a picturesque hill station in this belt, is famous for its world's largest and oldest juniper forests, where an average age of any given tree is estimated to be at least 1,500 years. Father of the nation, Qaid-e-Azam Muhammad Ali Jinnah spent his last days here. And an elegant Qaid residency stands tall as the abode of the great leader in his last days. Claiming Semitic lineage and tracing their origins back over 4,000 years to Aleppo in Syria, these predominantly pastoral nomad tribes have contemptuously guarded their free man spirit while grazing their herds of sheep, goats, and camels on scanty grass patches since time immemorial. Livestock serves as a backbone of the rural economy of Balochistan, contributing 20 billion each year to its exchequer. Although entirely arid land, Its fertility is surely reflected in the sweetness of its fruit produce. The fact that Balochistan produces almost 1 million tons of fruits annually not only reflect the land's agro-potentials, but also calls for establishing modern storage facilities, introduction of latest packing techniques, and establishment of fruit reprocessing plants to translate this yield into tangible profits for the farmers in the local and international markets. The Balochs, however, are not alone in claiming a distant ancestry. The vast coastal line of over 750 kilometers stretching from Hub Karachi to Gwadar Bay on Pak-Iran border is abode to the fishermen clans, commonly known as the Makranis. Their unmistakably Negroid Hamitic features link their ancestry across the sea to the distant lands of the Horn of Africa and to the slaves brought by the marching Arab armies and merchants in the 7th century. Baloch, Brehvi, Makranis, Pathans, Hazaras, and many others, these diverse people have coexisted side by side in sharp contrast to each other. And contrast does not always converge into conformity. It often spills out in conflict.
BLA, BRA, Lashkar-e Balochistan aur UBA in saron ne Quetta mein bahut sari killings ki jisme masoom nai dhobi teachers doctors civil society ke log Punjabi settlers unko bedardi ke sath qatl kiya gaya yahan par professors ko bedardi ke sath qatl kiya gaya usse ye situation develop hui ke na yahan pe koi karobar tha institutes hamare jitne health ke the wo band ho gaye jitne hamare education institute the wo tabah ho gaye to Balochistan ek tabahi ke dhane pe ek jalne ki position pe ja chuka tha.
What's happening in Khyber Pakhtunkhwa, what's happening in Balochistan, what's happening in Karachi, what's happening in Punjab? Extremist groups which don't have any sense of development are deciding our fate. The politician of this country should decide, who has got the real knowledge about the real problems.
Tribal wars, revolts, mutiny, and of late, the spread of terrorism targeting innocent Hazara minority in Quetta have been a painful but persistent set of episodes in Balochistan's far and near history.
Aman Balochistan ke log kul logon ne kharab nahi kiya hua hai wo ye nahi chahte ki hamare Punjab sab hum bhai samajhte hain Punjab ko bhi KPK ko bhi Sindh ko bhi lekin ya hamesha is tarah hua hai kabhi Shia aur Sunni ka masla paida kiya jata hai aur kabhi Baloch aur Pashtun ka masla paida kiya jata hai kabhi settled logon ko tang kiya jata hai aur ye wo log karte jo hamare dushman hain hamara mulk tarakki nahi chahte.
I don't believe in such a theory. Okay, I don't concern with the enemies of Pakistan. I am concerned with those who are sitting in Pakistan and they are cutting the nerve center of Pakistan. They are the helm of affairs. The rulers, the persons.
Agar yahan ke logo ko rozgar mil jaye, baizzat rozgar mil jaye, karobar ke mauke mil jaye, to unka phir yahan karastaniya khatam ho jayegi. Yahan ke sare log moye bawatan hai, watan dost hai, lekin apni ghurbat ki wajah se kisi gang ka hisab ban jata hai.
If Pakistan as a country has to see herself to the future, then Pakistani society has to take all those multifarious and multicultural, multi-ethnic groups together for its development.
Ethnic vanity adds to the fire, and hence a sorry saga of pride and prejudice. But the conflicts are not always by default. At times, they are by design.
The kind of opportunities Balochistan has, its resources, its wealth, its access, its geostrategic position, I guess that's the answer to all these questions. They know the true potential what this region has. In Balochistan, you know, such exploitations have been done by external factors, and to keep it on a turmoil base and which still exist.
As a matter of fact, all elements of geography and anthropology have been made to work against the interests of Balochistan. The difficult terrain has hindered the introduction of modern technology, forcing scattered patches of population to seek shelter and security from the resourceful, which in turn never showered favors without extracting a pound of flesh. Hence the abject poverty and underdevelopment of the province.
Sardari system of Balochistan ka. And usme sardar chosen hota tha is buniyad par ke uske paas kitni bahaduri hai, kitni sakhawat hai aur kitni akalmandi hai aur kitni samajh hai is buniyad par ye nahi hota tha ki baap mara beta baith gaya. Ab wo tamam cheezein ho gayi khatam. Ab sardar jo hai wo elder brother se nikal kar ek controller aur despotic ruler ban gaya. अब उसकी कोई अगर इज्जत नहीं करता, अगर करता है तो उसकी ताकत की वजह से, क्योंकि आज के दौर में डीपीओ भी उसका है, डीसीओ भी उसका है, एसएचओ भी उसका है, पटवारी भी उसका है, सब कोई उसका है, तो वो उसको दिल से मोहब्बत नहीं किया करते.
We have been having a very major issue of capacity building in Balochistan in terms of politics, in terms of local administration, in terms of education and other factors. That the people who really did not have the capacity to uplift themselves by having a good education or a good background of expertise in many other things.
Such vicious circle cannot break without giving people choices. Balochistan can never meet its destiny if it fails to empower its real strength. Its people.
आप यकीन माने कि अपने घर के अंदर वो जो ट्रीटमेंट देते हैं वो ऐसी होती है कि वो यानी उनको प्यार करने को जी चाहता है, लेकिन जब नौ आबादियात बन के आपके मेरे पास आते हैं तो फिर वो जालिम होते हैं. फिर वो तमाम ये जितनी इंसर्जेंसीज और जितनी आजकल देख रहे हैं आप, ये जो है वो लड़ाइयाँ झगड़े अपनी सुप्रीमेसी को कायम करने के लिए.
एजुकेशन इज दी priority number one for Balochistan. We have got about 11,000 primary schools in Balochistan, and as compared to those 11,000 primary schools, there are 800 or now maybe 900 middle schools. So there's a huge gap. So certainly 60% or 70% dropout rate is there.
आप सबसे पहले education का ऐसा plan बनाएं कि 10 साल के अंदर जो है बलूचिस्तान में ज़्यादा से ज़्यादा तालीम हो और ये क्वालिटी एजुकेशन. शऊर भी आ जाएगा, कबायली निज़ाम जो परवर्टिड हो चुका है वो भी दूर हो जाएगा, अनएम्प्लॉयमेंट जो है वो भी ख़त्म हो जाएगी, और नतीजा ये है कि खुशी खुशी जो है लोग आपका हिसाब बनना शुरू करेंगे.
पीस इज प्रीरेक्विजिट फॉर प्रोग्रेस. The timely actions have brought people's confidence back. Smiles return on faces as the national flag flutters with its finest glory to mark the national days of 14th August and the Defense Day celebrations of Pakistan on 6 September. These expressions of patriotism by the people of Balochistan do not only reflect their unwavering allegiance to their country, but also their unshakable trust in the state institutions. Restoration of the civil order has paved way for participatory democracy, which in turn is not only harnessing the fruits of development, but is also turning the cherished but distant dreams of prosperity into workable reality.
Gwalior Port is being considered as a gateway for China-Pakistan economic corridor vis-a-vis the trade from Pakistan. This project is vitally important for both China and Pakistan, not only for these two countries but also for the entire region. And it is a flagship project of One Belt One Road initiative of the Chinese government. And the, as you know, that the purpose of One Belt One Road is regional connectivity, and in fact that connects three continents, Asia, Africa and Europe. So in this way, Gwadar has to play a very great role.
Gwadar Development Authority has made a master plan, prepared a master plan to cater for all the future development, including the land zoning and the population growth, basic infrastructure, and all city amenities, including water, sewerage, solid waste management, and the road network of the city.
And implementation of those projects is an advanced stage for the East Bay Expressway, connects the port with the coastal highway. And from the coastal highway onward, we have the M8, which start from Gwadar up to Hoshiarpur. The second phase from Oshab to Khuzdar, and which connect to Sakkar, the eastern alignment, and the western goes to Quetta, it's expected to be completed by the end of 2016.
The passage of this new economic artery throughout the course of Balochistan will not only enable the region to re-emerge as a principal trading line of the Mehrgarh days, but it also promises the optimistic utilization of the province's untapped and virgin resources. Its arid agroeconomy, the mineral possessions, and the aqua coastal wealth.
If things do improve as what Pakistan, where Pakistan lies, so a lot of corridors in terms of pipelines, in terms of energy transmission systems, in terms of roads can be developed so that all can exchange their economic benefits, and Pakistan being strategically located in the center can benefit a lot from its transit fees, from its royalties, from its economic activities, from using its roads and many other such things.
Almost 70% of the coal now mined in Pakistan comes from Balochistan, and the reserves of natural gas here are amongst the largest in the world. The Jamalang coal mines, expanding over an area of 500 square miles, are the second largest in Asia. Balochistan has an estimated reserves of 217 million tons of coal, with a proven reserves worth of $500 billion. The Chaghi district, the largest administrative unit in Pakistan, is also the biggest repository of a huge variety of minerals. It has over 200 million tons of iron ore, repositories of precious metals, and is often nicknamed the marble capital of Balochistan. At the Sandak and the Rakodek fields, precious metals like gold, silver, and copper are being excavated. The estimated reserves in Sandak are 412 million tons, and that of Rakodek to be around 5.8 billion tons. In all, the untapped natural resources of metallic and non-metallic minerals of the province are estimated to be worth $1 trillion.
If you come to the middle part of Balochistan, which is basically Kalat, Khuzdar, Vard, and Lasvela, in these belts you'll find many different kind of minerals. You'll find a good quality of copper also, you'll find manganese, you'll find again iron ore, then we have barite, and then we have many other minerals. So there is a very big potential of really exploiting these mineral resources in Balochistan.
Yet another of the many bounties of Balochistan is its untapped marine and coastal wealth. The magic of the virgin beaches captivates as one drives along the Makran Coastal Highway. Along the road, the rocks change formations and bring to life living characters. The Hangul National Park has been identified as an area of global significance for its diverse ecosystems, endangered wildlife, and importance as a winter habitat for migratory birds. Nearby and throughout the course are the numerous shanty towns of Makrani fishermen. Their annual catch is over 15 billion rupees, which is merely a fraction of the total yield of the country.
We have a lot of opportunity within Balochistan coastlines where we can really build up nice processing units, which can be from fishing to storage to export, can really be opted on standard international standards and keeping all hygiene levels. And then we might be able to fetch very good high prices for these products.
70% of our population, work population, is fishermen, and we want to develop those fishermen, and we are talking with the Chinese government and Chinese companies to develop those fishermen. So we want to improve that, that there should be fiber optic boats. The storage and cold storage should be the within the boat, and they should be equipped with the latest technology, and so that they can bring and export their fish directly from Gwadar.
For strategists and planners, this amazing landscape is the future of the world. As the deep sea port of Gwadar emerges as the main game changer in the region, tiny hamlets of Pasni, Ormara, Juni, and Kech Bandar are also tipped as the future skyscrapers of the Arabian Sea coast.
It's not only the Gwadar. If you start from Karachi all the way, our coastal belt, up to Jiwani, Iranian border, it's about 1,100 kilometer long, which is 700 is in Gwadar district, the remaining is in Laswela district. So it has great potential for tourism. Our master plan covers it for the tourism potential there, but still we need to focus more on tourism development. It's a big industry. We have to tap at this industry, and now the security is very good in this area. Gwadar and all the coastal belt is safe.
What is more, the magic of the sea can attract tourists not only from within the country, but from all over the world. Pakistan's first deep water port is perfectly suited to provide all needed services to the trillion-dollar shipping lines of the Indian Ocean. The pinnacle of Pak-China Economic Corridor, Gwadar's port is set to trigger a new era of development in South Asia and its neighborhood. As a gateway to regional prosperity and national development, it promises unimagined economic revolution not only for Pakistan, but for the entire region, promising new job markets, enhanced skill development, and accelerated pace of growth.
2 million jobs under the CPEC project will be created in Pakistan, and Gwadar has a major chunk of this. So it's not only just the people of Gwadar, it's the people of the entire Makran, Balochistan, and Pakistan will be coming to Gwadar.
How the global trade is changing, how basically China is going and exploring other regions globally through Pakistan, through its southern corridor, through its central corridor, and through its northern corridor. How the Central Asian countries want to have access to the ports of Pakistan and other regions, and it's how important it's for Pakistan to be really stable and make the best out of this.
Zara usi ghurbat khatam hogi, usse rozgar ke naye mauqe milenge, tijarat ke naye marketing kholenge, bahut sare karkhane lagenge, yahan ki jo makami production hai wo duniya tak pahunch jayegi. To mere khayal mein phir koi banda aisa nahi ki apne mulk ke khilaf.
The long and dark decades of its neglect and depravity are fast receding to give way to a new age of quality education, career planning for its bright children, better health care, safe motherhood, clean drinking water, and modern modes of farming to ensure food security. And through this new path of opportunities, Balochistan is set to make a new beginning.
اگر بلوچستان کے سلکتے ہوئے مسائل پہ توجہ دی جائے ایک دفعہ پھر ہم اپنی اس ملک کی ترقی اور استحکام کے لیے ایک قوت ہم بن سکیں
جب وہ خوشحال ہوں گے جب وہ مطمئن ہوں گے جب یہ سمجھیں گے کہ یہ ہمارا ہے جب ہمارا کی بات آتی ہے تو آدمی کسی دوسرے دل کسی دوسرے دماغ سے اس کی حفاظت کرتا ہے
Amidst a cool, gentle breeze, as the sun settles in the deep blue waters off the astonishing wind-carved rock formations of Gwadar coast. The cheering boats of the fishermen return to the shore, negotiating through the sea tides. A high tide may provide enough depth to clear a bar, while a low tide may prevent entering or leaving a harbor, and the fisherman knows it well. But the speeding boats tell the riders are not worried. They, and indeed all in Balochistan, know that the tides of opportunity are high, and so are the chances to progress. Time is on Balochistan's side.